Okay, let's get things going. Studio 47 here. This is going to be a video about the behind the scenes of the Albert, Joe Albert video, history of Albert's Hall. The people in the video, one of them, Jim Butler, he worked from Saraville, and Ace, both from Saraville. Joe was from Saraville. Actually, when you're coming up Washington Road, Main Street, you go up that hill, that's Albert's Hill. The Alberts were, I would say, an affluent family in Saraville. And Jim, just two-thirds of the way up the hill, that's where Jim lived. And Ace didn't live far away. Me, I lived on Roma Street. Then turn to the right, it's Bailey Street, one Bailey Street. Number one Bailey Street was where I lived. Okay, Jim went to, retired at, I guess, 65 at DuPont's, which the ages came to light during the video. I guess Jim was, or Ace was 74 at the time. Jim was 72. Joe was 85. Now, Joe, after the completion of the tape, Joe lasted just a couple more years. And then I heard he was ill, and he was at his sister's, back at home on Albert's Hill. And I went to visit Joe, but he was on his deathbed. His sister, maybe 10 years later, I invited the Alberts, some of the Albert family. See, I went to high school with an Elaine Albert, and Elaine and her husband, Joe's sister. Joe's sister, after watching it, commented that I loved every minute of it, Mr. Bailey. So right there, that was worth it to me. Well, let me show you the camera. 1983 it was. I bought this baby. Look at it. Huh? RCA, top of the line. I'd put this baby, like, bigger than a loaf of bread. The handle, here you are, yours. You could hold it. Look at that baby, huh? Look. And I did a couple of weddings. And RCA, this son of a gun, 1983. It was maybe, it comes to mind, maybe 1,200, maybe more, I don't know. And my wife's sister worked for RCA, and she got the discount. So you can imagine. Today, the camera that replaces it is nothing. Tiny. No tape. This baby here had this big tape in it. Then years later, they came out with a smaller tape. Great progress. Great progress. Let me put this guy down on me. It was bigger than a loaf of bread. And besides that, you had on your side, you had the VCR, a regular VCR carrying around on your side. And then I think it had something, had to power it. I can't remember, this is 30 years now. I think I had a big battery on the other side. I mean, you were laden with equipment to just do something, but it was wonderful. To be able to record something, that was terrific. So anyway, you needed a subject. I was to do something of importance or something that'd be worthwhile. Joe Albert, I knew him, been there a few times, and a legend in South Jersey. And he's up in age, he's about ready to call it quits, and I went down and talked to Joe, and I told him about I had the camera. Maybe I had the camera with me, maybe I didn't. I don't even remember the first time. And I says, not today, Joe, not today. I'll bring Jim Butler and Ace Zaleski, and then we'll do it. It'll be easier on all of us. And it was. I come back a few days later with Jim and Ace and They were old friends, and it went easy. It was easy. Nothing to it and all. Now, you never see me, never, in a video, because I'm there with this big baby. Look at the size of that thing. I can't believe it. I can hardly hold it up at this age. By the way, my gun, my last thing, I had a big shotgun, a raised rib, Browning, big gun, you know, heavy, knock them down. Boy, and I got in a tree like 2 years, 3 years ago. I got in a tree and I lifted the gun. I said, let me try. Will I lift this thing? I lifted it. I'm pot hunting at the end of the day. I hunt with the club down at Brookville, but a lot of times it was getting up in age. I like to go sit down. So I practice. I lifted. I says, oh my God, I can't hardly lift it. No, luckily nothing happened that day. 2 days later, I'm back. I pot hunting again for the evening. And I practice. I lifted the gun. Oh, is this heavy? Oh my God. Good thing I tried it now. Then I look up. Here he comes. Here he comes. Oh, geez, a buck. Nice buck. I gotta do it now. I lifted that gun and I aimed down that barrel. And I said, don't miss him. Don't miss him. And boom, I fired and crumpled him and I got him. And all, and not even a kick. Nothing. I took his life in an instant. And at that moment, I retired the gun. That was the end of that gun. I gave it to myself, to my son, one of my sons. I let them choose which one was going to get that particular gun. And that was it. That was the end of that. That's the end of that story. Okay, we did the video. It laid, the tape laid for years. My cousin Ronnie used to bother me about that. He wanted to get his hands on that tape in a worse way, and I didn't even bother. Eventually, I would give it to him and everything, but and then he suggested the Historical Society and everything, but years had gone by, years. I would say 15 or more, and finally, there was a thing in a paper. They were opening the new Albert's Hall in town. They thought about building it near Joe's there, but they had a piece of ground, but it never got built there. So they're opening it. They're going to do it in town. It's in the newspaper. So I make a call. I didn't get any. I didn't get them. A couple of weeks or maybe a year or whatever. Finally, I call. And the fella comes to the phone, and he says, you've got a tape of Joe Albert of the home place? And they were looking, wanted a few pictures. And he didn't want to lose me off the phone. I'll be right back and everything. And then he must have got it, probably Roy Everett, Mr. Roy Everett, was in contact with me on with that phone call. And they came that night to get that tape. And I was happy that I had done it for the historical sake and for Joe and Ace's, Mr. Butler's family and Ace's family. And well, upon Mr. Butler's passing, and well, my wife and I were friends with Jim's wife and everything. We had dinner at their house. They had dinner at our house. So when Jim had passed, I did get together with Jim's wife and all, and my wife and all, very nice, and all. So that was good. At least that was done. But Ace's wife, see, I couldn't run hounds anymore. I had 15 hounds running in Monroe and disturbing and people and everything. One time at night, it went toward Jamesburg. I used to have a big plastic horn. I'd blow that horn trying to get the dogs. When I went into town to the store, the guy said to me, asked me, what is it? Because I was blowing that horn every now and then trying to get the... He says, what kind of animal is that they're chasing? When I was walking across the street, it dawned on me. I said, he thought that horn was the animal, a bull elephant or something. I don't know. So I was causing, people were good, tolerant, but it was building. Monroe was. I used to get mad when a car come down Prineville Road. I got mad. Would get mad. And then the lady runs the door, go over. Oh, I'm sorry. Nah, don't worry about it. It's not your fault. No, finally, the dogs was done. You couldn't run dogs up around home. No, you could do it down here with this big woods and everything. But I got rid of the dogs. And then kind of our friendship, we drifted apart a little bit. We have seen, but it wasn't the same. And Ace passed, and I said to one of his sons, I wanted to go over to see his wife before she passed, but it didn't happen. I didn't get there. So that's that. After the tape, immediately after, let's say within 5 years, I went to the site, and there was nothing there. It was down, the building was rubble, nothing. And it was a cold day. And I believe it was raining. And I reminisced a little and thought of my friends and that they were gone and how mortal we are. And it hurt. Today, it's the same way as that day 5 years later. It's gone. The home place is gone. Okay, so Roy Everett picked it up. That was the end of it. They had his truck. I guess they still have their truck, the Historical Society. And well, finally progress digitally and everything. And well, now I've got a site even. My site, if you Google Skip, that's my nickname, Skip B for Bailey. 32 the year I was born. Skip B, 32. The first one that'll come up, there'll be pages of stuff that Google search engine finds. There'll be pages when it comes up. The first one is Skip B, 32 on Smug Mug. If you go to that, you might find it interesting. Now, I made a DVD, gave a few out. I never gave it to the Historical Society. A few, you know, we're going back like 7 or 8 years ago. I never got it today. 5 years ago. I never got it today. Sorry. Gave a few out to the guys from our hunting club in Brookville and all that. And there's a few of them floating around. But I said, before I pass and everything, I wanted to get in touch with Roy Everett, the Historical Society. Maybe give him a couple and tell him that I managed to get it on YouTube. Now, YouTube, my Smug Mug site, will only take 20 minutes in length. YouTube will take 30. They did it for me. They took the 2 hours. So it's on there in its entirety, but it's too long. You can't hold people's attention for that length of time. So I decided to shorten it, to chop it. Now, to chop history, it's tough. It's tough. From 2 hours, I cut it to 30 minutes. That's discarding 3/4 of it. But I cut it. Fine. So there's the in its entirety, there's the shortened version. I was going to even make it a shorter because my site only take 20 minutes. And I said, I can't cut this thing anymore. My wife was like, what are you going to cut? You know, you're going to cut the Gladys Plain and Joe on the washtub? Or what are you going to cut? I had cut it terribly already, you know? So I says, it's got to stay like that. So for my side, I did a 9-minute piece. And when I call Mr. Reverend, just recently, at my age, I got one number wrong. The 5 and a 6, 5 or 6 in his telephone number. I made a mistake. And would you believe, the lady called me 3 days later and asked me who I was. And everything. She didn't know what I was talking about. And she spelled her name with E-V-R-I-T or something, and his is E-T or vice versa. And she was an Everett. What in the world kind of stupid... I'm telling you, somebody's looking at this from above or something and causing all this. I don't know. But But we got it straight, and we handled it with that lady. Her and I got along very well on the phone. I said to her, I'm gonna be 81 in a month. And she said, you don't sound like you're 80 years old, you know? But I am, and Joe was 85. My guess would be 87, 88 when I seen him on his deathbed. The pictures from the end. I knew they were under his mattress, and I says, I'd like to get him to loan me those pictures till I do that little bit, you know. And he offered. He says, you don't want the Bucky picture? Sure, I want the Bucky picture. And so that's how that came about. Oh, the Frank Sinatra song "My Way" for the end. Perfect. I mean, who lived their life his own way? A better example of it than Joe Albert. I mean, let's look at that for a second. How does a man go off in the woods and live? And all you got to go to work. You got to work. You got to earn a living. I told you the Alberts were a little affluent, and his father passed, and maybe I'm just guessing. I never asked Joe about his finances, but how do you go off and support yourself for how many years? 50? That's amazing. I couldn't. God, you couldn't get unemployment but he lived his life his way. It was perfect. When you went to Joe's, when the people come to Joe's, everybody had their place. There was like a tree log. And the deer stayed on that side of the log. This thing, when I look at it, everything's backwards. You touch his head, it's on the opposite side. God, you're crazy. The deer stayed on their side of the log. The people stayed on this side of the log. Joe sat on a porch. The people didn't get it, you know. Now, I could imagine, let's use our imagination a little bit. 100 people, probably Joe wasn't kidding. That thing grew, and 100 people, and a few beers, and an occasional riot. I was here. I don't drink anymore, but I've been in riots, and I fought my way. Look at my site, the confrontations, 1, 2, 3, and 4. There's 4 videos on confrontation, and on some stuff in another video. So I could imagine riots, mini riots, bottles, beer bottles laying around, cleaning up, and all that. So Joe had it. I don't blame Joe. Joe sat on a porch. The people stayed outside. But here's my point. To a friend, a person that was, and in the beginning I was no friend, you know. You stood outside and talked to Joe. He sat in his rocker and you spoke to him on a porch. My point being, to get to sit on the porch was like an honor. To be able to go to that door and greet him and walk in and sit down. Himself, and I like that honor. I'm just about 81. This fall, I'll be in that tree. It's my last place that I hunt. Some of the things that we used to do, we baited the deer. We were considered to be outlaw. Me, I was considered to be an outlaw. It was legal. I did it. They made it illegal. I'm gonna stop? No, I didn't stop. I had to hide. So I was considered like an outlaw. Now they allow everything. I love the fall. Loved it. When the leaves, everything turns, the South Jersey woods, the Parlin Bucklum. We had a fire, bad. But we rebuilt it a little bit. It's bigger and better than ever. And we've celebrated this year, our 80th year. 80, like Joe, 80. And I hope to make it to 100. I hope to be around for a while anyway. Okay, signing off. Thanks a lot for listening to me.